Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we just thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, we don't take it for granted that we get to come to church. What a privilege it is. There are people around the world that we acknowledge that are dying just to read pages of your word. And yet here we are today, worshiping with music and lights and sound and get to come in the comfort of an air-conditioned building. Father, we thank you for this privilege, Lord. What an amazing opportunity we have to come into the house of God. We don't come to hear from a man, from a woman, from the young or from the old. Lord, we come to hear from you, and we acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the leader of this house. Father, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with here at this church, and we don't ask these blessings that upon ourselves, but Lord, we ask them upon all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we don't ever think of ourselves as better or higher than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers in the body of Christ. It's so neat to see out in the world, Lord, those who we are family with, brothers and sisters working together to build the kingdom of God that we may never know, that they might be at another church, but Lord, we thank you that we are all working together to build your kingdom. So Father, bless the churches in the area, churches like Harvest and Sandals and churches like The Grove and Water of Life. Thank you for Ecclesia and Emmanuel Baptist. Lord, we thank you for all the different denominational churches like the Methodists and the Lutherans and the Episcopalians, our Catholic brothers and sisters, Seventh-day Adventist brothers and sisters. Lord, all the Calvary chapels across the Inland Empire and around the world, Lord, we thank you that you have blessed them as you would bless us. The Holy Spirit, speak to them as you are speaking to us tonight. Lord, most importantly, we come to hear from your Holy Spirit. So we ask, invite you now to speak into our hearts, to speak into our lives as we conscientiously shed our thoughts of what happened today or what's happening this week, and we spend this time to focus in on you. We ask and invite the Holy Spirit to be our teacher tonight. Lord, let it not be the words of a man, but Lord, let this be the inspiration and the teachings of your Holy Spirit that we might leave today filled with your presence, with the seed of the Word of God planted into our hearts that we might bear much fruit for the kingdom of God. And to you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name. We all said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, I thought what I would do in light of some recent circumstances, I thought I would kind of start off by telling you a story or an event that had happened to me and kind of go into it, and I'll tell you the title of the message after I tell you that. But I remember it was 4 years ago, my little boy Bjorn was born. He was born March 20th, and it was absolutely the greatest day of my life. I mean, everybody told me when Stacy was pregnant that we were going to have our firstborn. I mean, he was a surprise. We cried when we found out because we were like, wanted to travel and do all that stuff, you know. But everybody just said, you know, your life will never be the same. And I never quite got what that meant until I held my boy for the very first time that night. And I remember the moon was shining. I was in Redlands Hospital, and I just thought to myself, my life will never be the same. And it was just such a neat experience. And, you know, like many people do when they have a child or when they have a newborn baby, they take some time off. And I remember I had taken some time off of work just to spend with Stacey so she could recover, so that we could kind of get used to this whole, like, baby thing. You know, we weren't used to that. We had dogs. We thought that because we had dogs, that we would know what it was like to have a baby. But it wasn't even close. So I remember I took this vacation time to spend the first few days of my boy's life just kind of getting to know him and him getting to know us and just spending quality time. And it was right after my boy Bjorn was born that my best friend, Pastor Joe, who's in the youth ministry right now, 5 days later, his little boy Judah was born. And I remember, you know, I got the call, Stacy and I got the call that him and his wife Marnie, they were on the way to the hospital. And we were so excited because, you know, Pastor Joe, I give so much credit to that guy for who I am today. I mean, if it wasn't for him, you know, bantering me and pushing me, I would never have gone to Bible college with him, because he was just the one that would never leave me alone. He was my accountability partner growing up as a teenager and youth. I mean, him and I were everywhere together. We did everything together. He was like my best of friends. And I remember it was just so cool that we got to celebrate this moment. Like, boy, I had my firstborn son, and 5 days later, your boy's coming. And so I remember I was there in the hot or at home, and we got the call that Marnie was having the baby. Well, Stacy couldn't go because she had Bjorn, so I got in the car and I rushed over to the hospital, and I sat there in the waiting room with all of his family. And then he came out, and he had this look on his face, and it was just kind of this look of bewilderment. It was just kind of like, what's going on, you know? And he just said, "Hey, man, I don't know." He kind of told his family, I don't know all the details yet, but the doctors noticed some things about baby Judah, and they kind of took him away, And, you know, they're not going to let anybody come and see him, and nobody can go in right now, and they're going to hook him up to machines. And so we all just kind of sat there in this room like, what's going on? What's happening, you know? And I'm thinking to myself, like, what's the deal with this, you know? And I remember because I was a pastor at hospitals, clergy oftentimes are given special access because people want their spiritual leader or their spiritual guidance in moments of chaos and in moments of hardships like that. So they let me, because I was a pastor, go into the intensive care unit where baby Judah was there. He was only about 3 hours old. And he had every machine I've ever seen in a hospital hooked up to this little boy. I mean, every little thing. And there was Marnie and there was Joey. And Joey's just kind of, Pastor Joe's just kind of standing over him with this look, just kind of this blank look over his face. And I remember thinking to myself, what is going on? What is going on? God, this guy, for as long as I've ever known, has served him. I mean, Joey, if you've ever had a conversation with Pastor Joe, he's a walking Bible encyclopedia. I mean, that guy can quote scripture more than any person I've ever met. And he was like that when he was 14. We're in the youth group, and I'm this punk 14-year-old wanting to do my own thing, coming to church because my parents are pastors, and they've dragged me here. And here's Joey preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ to me, telling me that I got to get my stuff together, I got to get in with God. I mean, and I just remember thinking to myself, God, what is going on? Come to find out, Judah was born with a congenital heart defect, and he had some issues in his heart, and the hospital had said, you know, we don't have the facilities to take care of your baby here. We don't know if he'll live through the night. Give your boy 24 hours. And I remember I went home, told Stacy the news, and I was coming back that night, and it was visiting hours, and Marnie was up in the bedroom, and, you know, they weren't allowed to see Judah anymore. They were moving Judah over from Riverside over to Loma Linda, and I remember it was just Joey and Marnie without their baby. I remember 5 days earlier, they were there with us, with our baby, and we were all sitting in the room, in the hospital room, and we were celebrating, and we were ordering as much hospital food as we could because they told us we should do that, and what do you want to eat? What do you want to eat? And Stacy would call, and I want 4 chicken sandwiches, and it's all for me, and we were all just celebrating with flowers, and I remember walking up to the hospital, and there they didn't have their baby. There everybody was gone. The visiting hours were closed, and I remember I was walking up, and my dad called me, and he says, I want to tell you something. And I said, Dad, anything you can share with me right now, I could really appreciate, because I have no clue what to say to my best friend right now, whom the doctors just told him that his baby may not live the night. My dad just said to me, Luke, there's a lot of things that happen in life. And when things happen to people, oftentimes the very first and the very most important question we always ask is why? Why, God? Why? Joey and Marnie served God. Joey's been faithful to God all of his life. He was a man of God. He's a pastor. Why would God let this happen to him? He says, people ask why all the time. He says, the truth of the matter in our lives is we always want to know the answer to the question to why. But oftentimes that's the question we'll never get an answer to while we're here on earth. But he says, it's okay, because you don't have to know why. All you need to do is know who. You need to know who. That God is in control. That Jesus is on the throne. And I just said to my dad, I said, Dad, thank you so much. I walked up to that room, and I remember Joey and Marnie were just sitting in there. They didn't know what to do. Nobody was with them. I think, Pastor Dan, I think you and I went together. It was late at night. And I just told Joey, I looked at him. I just hugged him. No words needed to be exchanged. And I just looked at him and says, man, don't have to know why. You just have to know who. And we just prayed, shared the love of God on his heart. You know, and turns out Judah had, I think, 3 open heart surgeries in the course of a couple of months. The doctors put a valve in him, and you know, he's alive and kicking and well. And I mean, it's a great story. Joey tells it so much better than I, and I hope so. But you know, I remember at that moment thinking to myself, God, why? God, why? And then I began to think about it. And then I was out on vacation this last week, and it just brought back these feelings, because when I got back, I was in a place where I didn't have cell phone reception. And then I got back on Wednesday, and I had heard about Charleston. Everybody was like, did you hear about Charleston? Did you hear about Charleston? Did you hear about Charleston? I'm like, what's going on in Charleston? Another Charleston, man. And then all of a sudden we got it, and I looked up the news, and I found out What happened at Charleston? Young 21-year-old boy goes and sits in the back of a church prayer meeting on a Wednesday night, a night like tonight. Sits through the entire service and then opens fire at the end of that service and shoots 9 people dead. The question comes up again in my heart, in the nation's heart. God, why? Why? We always want to know why. Why do bad things happen to good people? We don't ask that question when it's bad people. Today at the title, they just saw they put it up. The title is not why bad things happen to good people, because my dad gave me the answer that I share with you today. So oftentimes in life, we may not know, we may never know why bad things happen to good people. But what we can do is we can know what to do when bad things happen to good people. Because maybe in your life, you've been there. Maybe you saw the news. I've got family members that are, you know, not necessarily believers or deep-rooted believers. And so anytime there's an event, anytime something like terrorist attacks go on, anytime, I remember when Sandy Hook happened, and they're just devastated. The very first question they see when they look me in the eyes, because they know I'm a pastor, they expect me to have the answer, is why would God let this happen? As a person, as a human, as a follower of Christ, I sit there looking at them like you look at me right now. I don't know. I don't know. Where was God in all of this? I don't know. But I know what we can do when bad things happen. Because you've experienced it. You've seen things like 9/11, like Sandy Hook and Columbine and Charleston. You've seen the things that have happened in Iraq and Iran. You've seen the natural disasters. And God, why? Why? We may never know the answer why, but we can know who, and that's Jesus. Maybe you have had something happen and you say, God, what did I do to deserve this? I'm the good person. Why are bad things happening to me? See, I believe that when we look at that, there's a lot of things that go on. Emotions start to go back and forth and reel in our heads, and we try to make sense of what's happening, and we try to gather together, and we try to have the answer, and we try to stand there and encourage. I remember walking into that hospital just expecting to have the answer from my friend. This is what God says. And I walked in there, I had nothing to say. But I remember him telling me later, oh man, just you being there. You sitting in the waiting room when I wasn't even there with your family, just hanging out for hours on end. That's what I needed. So there's things that we can do when bad things happen. And it might be to us what you can do when bad things happen to you, or what you can do when bad things happen to others. And I believe that the Bible sheds a lot of perspective, because what happens is we get wrapped up in perspective. You know what I'm talking about when I say we get wrapped up in perspective? My mom always told me like this, Luke, you don't see life as it is. You see life as you are. That's our perspective. We don't see things as they are. We see things as we are. Even when we read the gospel, even when we read the word of God, we always see things through the way our culture provides it. Sometimes it's so hard to read, and you're thinking, like, what are they talking about? Because our culture is completely different than the culture thousands of years ago. But I believe when we look into the word of God, when we look into God's heart, we can see that there's a little bit of perspective as Christians of what we can do to live a life that's grounded, that's based on the word of God, so that when bad things happen, we don't get rocked. Because when bad things happen to good people, it shakes our world. I've been there. I think every person in this room can remember what happened or where they were the morning of September 11th. The moment it happened, we can remember. Why? Because when bad things happen to good people, it shakes our world, shakes our foundations. And when we get a little bit of perspective about the Bible, what the Bible says, just to lead us and to guide us and what we can do, I believe it really helps to ground us in those events. So today I thought what we do is just look at what the Bible says about this, and some truths that we need to understand. Just a couple of truths, and we'll take some application and talk about that at the end. But what does the Bible say about this? Well, first and foremost, as far as perspective goes, some things that we need to understand about when things happen to bad people. We need to understand that we live in a fallen world. We live in a fallen world. The question, why? God, why? Why would you allow people who serve you, who are in a Bible study meeting, who are innocent in a building, or somebody around the world, God, why? And the answer lies in the fact that we are living in a fallen world, a cursed world. We so often, because of this curse that's on humanity, because of the decisions made long ago that we are reaping the benefits of, we so often look for blame. You think about the very first incident when a bad thing happened to a good person. Eve partook of the fruit and she handed it to Adam. The very first thing, we want to know why. Why? Because we want to find the blame to help resolve the emotional turmoil. To resolve the issue so that we can move on. Adam, the very first thing he says, it's the woman you gave me. So the question as to why is seeking for us to know the age-old Adam of who can we blame for what has happened. But the fact is that we live in a fallen world, a world that is brought by a curse. A world of humanity. I mean, the flesh does not have to be trained to be evil. Do you know what I'm talking about? I don't have to wake up in the morning and be like, okay, I'm gonna practice being evil. I'm gonna practice lying. I'm gonna practice stealing. I'm gonna practice cheating. I'm gonna practice gluttony. I'm gonna practice selfishness. Because I wanna get really good at that. We don't have to practice. We're born experts. But you see, our flesh, we have to practice doing the things of God. When we realize that this is a world that's a fallen world, it's not a perfect world. It's not rainbows and sunshine. Because of this fallen state of humanity, it's a guarantee that hardships will come our way, whether we're good, whether we're bad. Jesus tells his disciples in John, the 16th chapter, he's telling them, he says, man, he's kind of alluding to his crucifixion coming up, and he says, you're going to get scattered. They're going to persecute you. They're going to chase after you. Everybody's going to go every which way. And John 16, he says, I tell you these things that you may have peace. What? That's not peace, to tell me that my life's going to fall apart, that my whole foundation is going to get rattled and shaken, that everything I've stood on and everything that I've believed on and everything that I thought was good and pure and whole and just is about to be ripped from my arms. That does not sound like peace. But he says, I tell you these things that you might have peace. Why? Because in the world, you will have tribulation. In the world, you will have tribulation. But I love how Jesus says, but be of good cheer. Why? Because I have overcome the world. We've got to get a primer, a dose of perspective in our lives. Because what happens, I believe, with us Christians is we get into this relationship with Jesus and we have these expectations based on culture of a utopia here on earth. Because Jesus did say, I have come to give you life and more abundantly. So what we do, culturally speaking, is we take abundant life with everything good happening to us. But Jesus talks about abundant life so much deeper than just the circumstance or the moment of what's going on, a utopia here on earth. Yes, we have that in the future. We'll talk about that. But we have to get this perspective in life that Jesus tells us there will be tribulation. There will be hardships. God, when he spoke to Adam, he says, because you have done this thing, I will curse the ground. You will toil for your food. The ground will put forth thorn and thistle at the same time. You will have to decipher the good and the bad because these are the consequences of the fallen nature of humanity. And so when we get this perspective that, you know what, life's not full of daisies and rainbows and unicorns and utopian dreams because we've got Jesus in our lives. Yes, we've got Jesus, so therefore when we go through the storms, we don't have to worry about the boat sinking because he's in the boat, but that doesn't mean that we won't face the storms. We've got to have the perspective in life to realize that there will be good things and there will be bad things that happen to good people that we cannot answer to, that we cannot explain, but all we know is that this is a world that is a fallen world, but like the Bible tells us that we are pilgrims, sojourners, we are travelers walking through this dimension, waiting and longing for our eternity later on in a world where there is no weeping, in a world where there is no night, in a world where there is no pain, no sickness. Why? Because that is our final destination. But along this path, we will have rocks and stumbles. It's just the way it happens. I know you probably came into this place thinking, man, I was really hoping for a better answer than that. I know, me too. But we live in a fallen world, a cursed world. But this is not our final destination. It's not our final destination. Some things about perspective, some things that we ought to understand out of the Word of God about when good things happen to bad people is that God is always present. Now, that is either the biggest amen or the biggest oh man right there. I mean, you think about it. God is always present. He wasn't absent on September 11th. Can I just be real? He wasn't absent in the period of 1930 to 1944, during the Holocaust. He didn't take a vacation in Charleston, South Carolina last week. God is always present. And that's either a great comfort to us as Christians, or that's a great discouragement to us, because we wonder and we ask and we seek, God, if you're always there, why did you let this happen? And again, it goes back to this word, perspective. We believe, we get into this idea because of our culture, because of the way we've been trained, because of our mindset, because of movies and because of society, that God is this puppet master, that we are like these little puppets, these marionette dolls. Uh-oh, I broke it. Don't tell Pastor Mike. Oh, okay, I fixed it. That God is the one that just controls these strings, and that all I have to do, I'm just waiting, God, move my string. And that God is this great puppet master. Why? Because if God is always present, God is always in control, which means God is making the decision for every move I make. But the problem with this type of a theology, that God is the ultimate puppet master of our life, is it devoids the most important aspect of humanity. And you know what that is? Free will choice. There is a difference between God's perfect will and God's permissible will. You may not have ever heard that before. There's God's perfect will. God's perfect will be done no matter what happens. Like, let me give you an illustration. Jesus Christ was God's perfect will. It would get done. It was. How about this? Paul the Apostle's conversion, the spread of the gospel at the time of Paul the Apostle, that was God's perfect will, which means if Paul didn't do it, somebody else would have done it. Would have gotten done. And then there's God's permissible will, which means to you and I, God's there. He's present. He may not like it. He may not want it. It may not be his best option for you and I, but God says, you are making that choice, and I will allow you to make that choice. A real easy, superficial example of God's permissible will. I can go and I can eat as much as I want and get as big as I want and be as unhealthy as I want and live a short life because I'm a glutton. And God won't stop me. He won't tug the strings of my life because he's not the ultimate puppet master of me. Why? Because God gave me a free will. God gave me an intellect to make the decisions that I want to make. He will never violate our free will. He'll use us, but he uses his willing servants. And so when we understand that, we ask this question, God, why would you allow this to happen? Because God comes back and he says, because I gave you the choice as humanity. I may not like it. I may not agree with it. I think it's a terrible choice. I think you're hurting a lot of people with that choice. But I gave you free will to do what you choose to do on this earth. And because of the first idea, the first perspective that we live in a fallen nature, now we live in this realm where we have the responsibility to do what God would have us to do in our lives. God has given to us this free will, but we have the understanding to know that God is always there. God is always there. His presence is always there. I love how Job is complaining. I didn't have it on the overhead. Job is complaining. I mean, his life, I mean, why do good things happen to, or bad things happen to good people? Read Job. And here Job's griping. Man, he's complaining. He's just going to town. And in Job, I think it's 34, God says, all right, Now I want you to stand up like a man and answer these questions. Okay. God says, where were you when I formed the earth? Where were you when I stretched out the expanse of the heavens? Do you know when the sheep on the mountain give birth? Have you ever experienced what it's like, Job, to be in a thunderbolt? Have you ever been to the depths of the sea or to the expanse of the universe? Because I have. You see, God is always there. Regardless of whether it's a good or it's bad, God is there. And we can either see that as a, well, God, why? Or we can realize God has given to us the choice, the decision, the recognition that we can choose to follow God. We can choose to seek after God. We can choose to love our God despite what happens in our culture, in our society, to us or to others. God is always there. His presence is always there with us. Moses, as he's encouraging the people of Israel on their way into the promised land in Deuteronomy, Moses tells everybody, he says, hey, the Lord is the one who goes before you. He'll be with you. He'll not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be dismayed. Church, bad things happen to good people, but all along, God is there. God is there. I know that's a hard answer. I know once again, you're saying, Pastor Luke, that's really not the answer I was hoping you would say. You see, this is a wicked world. Like the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy that this is the end times. That men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. They'll be harsh to each other. They'll have a form of godliness but deny its power. We are living in these times and God is there. This is a harsh world, but God has given us the choice, and that is why now you and I need more than ever to tell this world about Jesus. Because he's not the reason bad things happen. Well, God, I can't serve God because he let this happen. God says, I want you to serve me so these things don't happen. This world needs Jesus. This world needs a message of the cross more than ever before. Because it's divided. Listen, I'm a young guy. Maybe I wasn't aware of it when I was growing up, but it seems to me that our country is becoming more racially divided than it has been in a long time. And this world needs Jesus more than it ever has before. It's become more culturally divided. Well, I'm this or well, I'm that. It's become more economically divided. Well, I'm up here or I'm down there. This world needs Jesus more than it ever has before. And you and I are the vessels that tell the world that God is there with you. I was just on my way up that trip on the side of the road, and there was a lady. She was sobbing at the gas station. I thought to myself, oh, man. I just want to get to my spot. I've been driving for 7 hours. I'm so tired. And she says, sir, I need help. And I'm like, let me see if I have cash. She says to me, I don't need cash. I just need gas. And I said, all right, you know, pull your car over. Came up, and turns out she was on her way back to our area. And I just told her, I said, man, she's crying. She made some bad decisions. I just said, you just need to know something. Jesus loves you. And that the decisions that you've made that got you this point, all right, your life's a chaos. It's a disaster. But just take it one step at a time. Do you know Jesus? And she talked about it a little bit. I needed to hear about Jesus today. And I'm like, he loves you. He loves you. He's here with you. He'll comfort you. And she gave me a big old hug. She's like, you're an angel. And I'm like, no, I'm not. You see, God is always there. I think of this story of Lazarus. You guys remember the story of Lazarus? The story of Lazarus. God is always there. God is always present. They come and they tell Jesus, hey, Lazarus, whom you love, he's sick. We need you to come now. And the Bible tells us, it's the craziest verse I've ever read. The Bible tells us that because Jesus loved Lazarus, he remained where he was for 2 days. Because Jesus loved Lazarus, he didn't rush to his side. So then Jesus gets to Bethany where Lazarus is at, and by the time he gets there, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. So a lot of time has expired. And so 3 times Jesus hears from the sisters and from the people, if you were here, Lazarus wouldn't have died. Martha tells him that when he gets to Bethany. Mary comes out after weeping for her brother, and she sees Jesus, and she says, Jesus, If you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And the people that were wailing and crying and mourning for Lazarus, they come up to Jesus and they say, Jesus, if you would have come, Lazarus wouldn't have died. And Jesus begins to pray. And he says, oh God, I thank you that you hear me. I thank you that what I say, Lord, that you have given me the power and the enable. And I don't say these words for me. I say these so that they would know you're in control. You're always there. And Jesus speaks, Lazarus come forth, and Lazarus rises from the dead. You see, Jesus was always there. He knew what was going to happen. Despite the hardships that we face with trials, when bad things happen to good people, God is always there. God of comfort, God of restoration, a God of peace, to speak to us, his people, as our heart is ripped in half. We say, God, why? God says, God, who? I'm here with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Some things that we need to understand about the Word of God and what the Word of God says about when bad things happen to good people is that God can take what is bad and turn it into good. It's so important for us to see. You know what happens is we get that statement, oh, that's so good, Pastor Luke, I love that, amen. Finally today, tonight, it's only been an hour almost, you finally said something, I want to amen too. The hardship is that oftentimes these things don't transpire in the timeline we want. God, there's a disaster that happened over here. God, I'm waiting for you to turn this into good. And we watch the news every day. That's not the good yet. It's not the good yet. It's not the good yet. But you see, God, I love what Rick Warren said it like this, man. So good. God is really good at taking crucifixions and turning them into resurrections. God can take that which is bad, that which is devastating, that which changes the world and rocks our foundations and makes us even question our very belief in God. And he's so good at taking those moments in our life and turning them around for good, turning them around for glory, turning them around for something so somebody might see. I remember there was a moment in my life when I was in high school. A couple of kids walked into Columbine High School with trench coats and shotguns. And they killed the students of Columbine High School. I remember that. And I remember in my youth group, Pastor Eddie Elguera talked about a young girl, and I'll never forget her name. Her name was Cassie Bernal. And the young man who was killing everybody walked up to her and said, I know she was part of her Christian club. And he said, deny your God. And she said, I would not. And they shot her there dead. But yet here, what, 20 years later, 17 years later, I'll remember that girl's name for the rest of my life. And I'll remember that if I ever have the opportunity, I will never walk away from the God I so love and the God I so serve, because she was a living example of somebody who was dedicated to Jesus Christ even at a young age. That doesn't make it right. And listen to this. Oh, please hear me. God does not make bad things happen for his glory. Well, God must be doing this so that the world would see. Listen, let me tell you something. I fully believe with all of my heart that is not the way God works. That God does not create bad things to happen in good people's life so that somebody might see some goodness in God. I believe that God can take the bad things of this world and turn it around for his glory. Why? So that we would have something called hope. As a matter of fact, in Romans, in the 5th chapter, we'll just put it up on the overhead. Paul the Apostle speaks, he says, not only that, but we glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character, and character, hope. I love what he says in verse number 5. Hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. When bad things happen to good people, we know that God has the ability to take what was meant for bad and turn it into good. Why? Because we have this one word in our hearts, hope. It may not happen in our lifetime. It may not happen in this millennium. It may not happen in this century. It may not happen in this decade. But we know that God is a God who's really good at taking crucifixions and turning them into resurrections. And because of that, we live and we operate in this thing called hope. And it does not disappoint, because it was given to us by the Holy Spirit on the inside of us. So we know that there's a light at the end of the tunnel. I think of the story of the young boy Joseph. You remember that story? Remember Joseph and his dreams? He wasn't really good at communication when he was young. You don't have as many brothers as Joseph had and tell them, I had a dream from God that you'll all bow down to me, and see the look on their faces and the disdain and the anger that they had for him. And then like the next day say, I had another dream from God that you're gonna bow down to me. If you know the story, they throw him in a pit. They're gonna kill Joseph. They decide, you know what, we can't, at least he had a couple decent brothers that said, we can't kill him. So let's just sell him into slavery. Good job. Good idea. Way to be a brother. And there Joseph sold into slavery into Potiphar's house. You know the story? Things start looking up for him. Okay. Maybe it's not so bad. He's got the control all over everything Potiphar has. And then all of a sudden, a bad thing happens to a completely good person. Potiphar's wife comes and ruins Joseph's life again. So then there's Joseph in the prison. Well, all right. You know, it's pretty bad. It's better than being in a pit, I suppose, or being dead. Things start to look up, and they make Joseph the leader of all of everything in the prison. And then Joseph hears a story, and he says, man, you've got the Pharaoh's ear. Just remember to mention my name. And what happens? Joseph is forgotten. Bad things happen to good people. And then, you know the story. Joseph is elevated because of his interpretation of the dreams of Pharaoh. And at the end of Jacob's life, the end of all of this, the end of everything that's done, Jacob's life, when he's dying and the brothers are afraid, Joseph says to his brothers at the very end of Genesis, he says, what you have meant for bad, the Lord has made into good. It took Joseph his entire life sitting in a prison as a slave. But you see what God, what the world meant for bad, God turned it around for good in Joseph's life. He says, God did this so that I would save the lives of many people, including his entire family, all of Egypt during the famine. And God set up the Exodus with Joseph so that the Israelites could partake and they could receive their promised land. God is really good at taking crucifixions and turning them into resurrections. We have hope. So these things of perspective, these ideas of what the Word of God says, they're great. But what does that mean for you and I? What do we do? Okay, we understand, but now what do we do when bad things happen to good people? What do we do? Because that's the million-dollar question. That's the question that will determine our lives, the outcome of our lives, the outcome of our children, the outcome of our nation, the outcome of our church, the outcome of people that we may never even meet or know around the world. What we do when bad things happen to good people? Because it rocks our world. So what do we do when bad things happen? It's so easy. We do this. Keep on going. Keep on going. Keep on going. I remember that moment when I was thinking back to Judah. God, why? In my heart, I was a little mad, upset. Why would you allow this to happen? Discouragement settles in. Emotions settle in. Doubt creeps in. And all of a sudden we begin to listen, and the enemy takes advantage of that and says, now you realize that you're serving a God that is distant or not real. And all of a sudden there's this disconnect that happens when bad things happen to good people. But the best thing we could do for us and for those around us when bad things happen to good people is for us to keep on going. To not stop, to not pause our race, to not stop and doubt and wonder and question, but to keep progressing forward in our walks with God, because that is what God's desire for us, church, is to keep on going. Man, I think if there's anything that's a light that's shining out of this Charleston incident, and it's so fresh and it's so new, I don't believe God's even remotely done. But just to hear the victims' families on national news tell the murderer, I forgive you, once again paints the picture of Christians no longer being bigots in a nation where they think Christianity is becoming unpopular, that people are better than everybody else, that Christians are closed-minded. Now for somebody to look somebody who just killed their family members in their face and say, I can forgive you because of Jesus Christ. Now God's glory is beginning to shine. Why? Because they did not stop. It's hard. I know I said it's easy. The statement's easy. The action's hard. It's so difficult to progress when a thing is taken from you. When your family is ripped apart, maybe you've lost a child, and you say, God, how can this happen? How do I keep pressing forward? One day at a time. One step in front of the next. You might take two steps forward and one step back, but I love how Pastor Dan said it. You still made progress. Keep moving forward. If you've got your Bibles, we'll conclude with this thought. Go with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians in the fourth chapter. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Paul the Apostle is talking about afflictions. He's talking about suffering. He's talking about hardships. I mean, if there's a guy who knows about what happens when bad things happen to good people, it's Paul the Apostle. Shipwrecked 3 times. I've never been shipwrecked 1 time. Bitten by a snake. I've had a couple close calls, thank God. I mean, this guy's beaten, stoned, left for dead, and eventually, guess what? Killed. But despite all of that, never stopped running his race. I love at the end of his life, he says, I have run the race. I have finished the faith. Look at this in verse number, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We'll start in verse number 8. He says, we're hard-pressed on every side, yet we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always caring about the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our body. Look at this man's perspective in life. Man, Paul's saying, I've had some really crummy things happen to me, but I've never been so far beyond where God wasn't there. I've never been so far gone where God didn't bring me back. And he says, even in the fact that I have these problems, even in the fact that I have these afflictions, I'm caring about the death of Jesus that you might see that as I run my race, I'd be an example to you to know that you too can run your race. That when bad things happen to good people, you don't have to stop. But keep going on in your relationship with God. Keep pressing through the doubt. Keep pressing through the pain. Keep pressing through the fear. Keep pressing through the questioning. Keep pressing through the despair. And do not stop. He begins to talk about these afflictions. And he says to these people, keep on going. A couple verses down, he says in verse number 16, therefore we don't lose heart. Don't let yourself get so discouraged by what's going on in your life or in the life of somebody that you love or in what's happened to you or what's happening somewhere else. Don't let yourself get so wrapped up in discouragement that you lose heart. Church, remember, Jesus is always there. That's why it's important for us to know that God is always present in our lives to never leave us nor forsake us. Don't lose heart, Paul says. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Oh my goodness, it's so good. He even goes on. For our light affliction. Really? Seriously, Paul? Light affliction? Shipwrecked 3 times? Beaten? Left for dead? In prison? This is not a light affliction. That's like, okay, that most normal people would re-examine, like, is this really what I'm supposed to be doing? But Paul says, man, I have a perspective that even though this journey is tough, listen, church, even though your journey right now might be as gut-wrenching and as hard as it possibly can be, it's not your destination. It's not your destination. You're traveling, sojourners, pilgrims, making a journey. It might take many years, it might take many decades. You're making a pilgrimage. You're not arriving at your final destination. So he says, this is a light affliction. This is a rain on a sunny day when you didn't have the raincoat. You'll get through it. Why? Because when you reach your final destination, you'll look back and realize, God, you're so good. God, even though this happened and this happened and this happened, I count it all as light affliction because of the rewards that are set before me. Our light affliction, but for a moment, what is working is a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. We don't look at the things which are seen. We look at the things which are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Paul's saying, listen, even when doubt creeps in, when heartache settles in, when insecurity comes your way because of bad things happening to good people or even you, keep on going. Keep on going. Why? Because you are on a pilgrimage, a journey to a better place, a place where this will be all a light affliction, the worst thing. You say, Pastor, you don't even understand the pain I've been through. I don't. I've seen your stories. I've heard, I've sat with some of you. I can't even relate. But God knows. God's there. His comfort and His presence is always there with us. Let us not lose heart. Let us not stop going. And press forward. Why? Because there's a glory, a far better destination than the journey that we're going on right now. What do? Keep going. My mom, she had this Persian rug. You know what I'm talking about, those Persian rugs? Kind of the design. I don't like the designs of them. I remember when she got it. It was super scratchy. It was super itchy. It was so uninviting. It was just like, ugh. It was ugly, and it's an uncomfortable rug. And I remember over the years, it was around a coffee table, it was around the couch, and everybody would walk on it, they'd step on it, spill their food on it, carry their nasty, dirty, oily feet on it, whatever it might be. And I remember as the years went by, people would stop laying on the couch, and they'd start laying on the rug. This rug that many years ago was scratchy, was itchy, was uncomfortable and hard, all of a sudden became soft and plush and inviting. Because a Persian rug, the more you step on it, the more you walk on it, the more you abuse it, the more you break it in, the better it becomes. Christians, we are like a Persian rug. The more you walk on us, the more you step on us, the more you press against us, the more the dirt of this world gets rubbed on us, the better we become. Why? Because we know that we are travelers on a journey, sojourners and pilgrims walking through the valley of the shadow of death. But while we are here, we will fight the fight, we will finish the race, and the world will see that despite what happens to us, that we will love a God and we will serve a God and we will not abandon our God. Why? Because we have a greater perspective on life, that even though we may never know the answer as to why bad things happen to good people, we know all along that Jesus Christ is on the throne. And as long as Jesus is in me, greater is me, and He is He in me than he that is in the world. And I can and I will make it through this life. That is when this world will change, is when we rid ourselves of these shallow perspectives of God being our puppet master, of God orchestrating every little move. God says, I've given you the choice. I've given other people the choice that will affect your life. But regardless, I'm still God. I'm still good. I'm still righteous. You still serve me. You still follow me. You still seek me. And you will find yourself at the end of your life, at your destination, if you remain faithful and loyal to Jesus Christ. As Jesus says, those who endure to the end shall be saved. Church, this world needs Christians to stand strong as we shake. As all this world goes, listen, it's only going to get worse. The Bible tells us that in 2 Timothy, the third chapter, it's only going to get worse. I like how they said it in Batman, right? The night is darkest in the dawn, right? Or something like that. It's darkest in the dawn before the light. It's darkest before the dawn. Exactly that. Jesus is coming soon. And this world needs to see the model example of a steadfast Christian that will be immovable and unshaken because of their foundation in their God. We can make it through. When bad things happen to good people, we may not know who or may not know why, but we do know who. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Because of Him, we can make it. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Let's do this. Let's just pray together, because I sense that the Holy Spirit wants to work in our hearts. And some of us have experienced some amazing atrocities in life that I can't even imagine enduring through, but yet you're here today. The Bible tells us that the God is a God of comfort. So let's just pray today. Just seek after God. Seek after His promises. So would you join me today? Father, we come before You. Lord, I'm just so glad that Your word gives us peace and rest. Lord, how Your word says that be anxious for nothing, but in everything let our prayer and supplication be known to You, and requests be made known to You, that the peace of God that surpasses understanding would guard our hearts and our minds. Today, there are many of us in this place that have endured amazing hardships. Lord, there are those of us in this place that are about to endure hardships that we can't even dream or endure. But yet, Lord, we rest in the fact that despite the world crumbling around us, we look to you and we have peace because we stand on the rock. When the wind and the waves come, we stand on the rock of Jesus Christ because we are founded in you. Founded in the word of God that tells us in 2 Corinthians in the first chapter that you are a God of comfort. Lord, that you would comfort us in our very time of need. So Lord, that someday we would be a reflection of your goodness and your glory to comfort somebody when they need to know you are a God of comfort. Holy Spirit, I just ask tonight that your presence, your spirit would fall upon those. Fall upon us, your church today. Speak to us. Reveal your heart to us. Reveal your presence to us. Reveal your peace to us. Reveal your comfort to us. Your steadfast love for us that's immovable, unshakable. As Paul the Apostle says, Lord, though we're led to the slaughter every day, despite all of these things, we are more than conquerors. Why? Because we have Jesus. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we stand on the word of God. Lord, I just pray that you would speak to people, Lord. Move on their hearts. Direct them and lead them and guide them, Lord. Your word says that your word is a lamp unto our feet and a guide unto our path. Your word says that all things work to the better of those who are called and according to your purpose. So, Father, I pray that you would begin to orchestrate paths, Lord. Send laborers across, people of encouragement to not, if anything, to not say anything, but just to be there to support, Lord, that we would stand with each other, brothers and sisters, to endure the storms of this life that we might make it to our final destination, a glory, a far better value than this life. Holy Spirit, speak to your people tonight. Move in this place tonight. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Well, God is good. Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave today, I want to just give you the opportunity. I don't know all of you in this place. It would be a shame to leave under the assumption or the pretenses that everybody's in the right place with God. When in the truth, there are those of you in this place that you need to get yourself right with God. You need to stop messing around, stop playing games. The Bible says that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not about me. It's not about, what a man says. It's about God speaking into your heart right now. So often what happens is we live under these pretenses, or we think, or we have these assumptions that because everything's okay in my life, that means, it must mean that I'm okay with God. We have these assumptions that, you know, if I go to church or if I sit in church and I hear the pastor preach, that means I'm going to go to heaven. If I give, or if I get involved in church, or if I profess to be a Christian, that must mean that, you know, everything's in line in my life. But let me tell you something. There's nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you have these assumptions, because you've given yourself titles, because you've thought of certain thoughts, because you were baptized or christened as a baby or went to Sunday school classes, nowhere in the Bible does it say that those are the things that get you in the right alignment with God. The Bible tells us that we ought to examine ourselves from time to time, to look into our hearts. Because the truth of the matter is that, listen, we're all one virus, we're all one accident, we're all one epidemic or incident away from our eternal destiny. You see, we're eternal beings. We have an option, a decision to make here on earth that decides our eternal destiny, whether we spend eternity in heaven or eternity in hell. Whether you believe it or whether you don't, whether you think, man, I never landed on that. I saw that movie. I heard that one book was fake. Listen, you can bury your head in the sand about the subject of eternity all you like. It does not make it go away. Heaven's a real enough place for God to speak about it in the Word of God. Real enough for Jesus himself to speak to us about it. Real enough for the Bible to be preserved over thousands of years that we might take it seriously today and examine our hearts and examine our lives. And the way I want you to examine your life is to ask yourself, well, you know what? If I was to face my mortality today, if I was to die, would I go to heaven or would I go to hell? Because how you answer has a lot to say about your relationship and where you stand with God. You can't get to heaven based on assumptions, based on hope, based on desires, based on wishes. Listen, you can't get to heaven based on good intentions. You've probably even heard the statement, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So many times we think, well, if I'm a good person, good people go to heaven. Our parents tell us that as kids so that we'll behave. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, that means you're going to get into heaven? The Bible tells us that our righteous deeds, our good deeds, according to God's righteousness or compared to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. That's our good deeds. What do you imagine what he thinks about our bad deeds? You see, nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough. We can't work our way. We can't earn our way. We can't buy our way into heaven. The only way you and I can get to heaven is God's way. That's through Jesus. Jesus Christ said these words, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today, I want to offer you the invitation to accept this gift. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept this gift. You see, the only thing you and I can ever do is to accept it. Like any gift, you have the choice, free will. God's not a manipulator, he's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way, and you've got the choice whether you want to accept or to reject the gift. Your choice. Jesus said these words, John the 3rd chapter. He says, unless you're born again, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That's my paraphrase when I say that. When you think, oh, born again, what does that mean, born again? Listen, it's not what you think. It's not what Hollywood's made it out to be. Born again has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God through his son, Jesus. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to you and I, the church, to us. And he says, you think that you're all right. You think that you're rich. You think that you're wealthy. You think that you're clothed in splendor, but you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are. His plea to the church, he says, oh, I wish that you would stop doing things your way and come to me and buy from me, he says. He says, there'll be a time, he says, when I'm coming back and I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. And that's a shocking and it's a crude statement that Jesus is making, but it's his final plea in the word of God for us to stop doing life our way and to start doing life God's way. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. Occasional church attendance, doing your own thing, doing some of God's thing. We'll say it like this. You're riding the fence. Jesus says, man, if that's you, you're not going to make it. Listen, I love you enough. I respect you enough today to tell you the truth that you can't hope your way into heaven. You can't wish your way into heaven. You can't work your way into heaven. You can't sit your way into heaven because of your church attendance. And certainly you cannot desire your way into heaven because you've been living a lukewarm life. You're just not going to make it. But that doesn't have to be the final outcome of your life. Like I said, we're all travelers on the journey of life. Pilgrims, as the Bible describes. The situation, the predicament, the area that you're in right now does not have to be the rest of your life. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and you might have life abundantly. You see, there's a hole on the inside of you that you've tried to fill it with hobbies, with money, with friends, with relationships. Yet despite what you try to do to fill it, you can never fill that hole on the inside. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole meant to be filled with the life of Jesus Christ. And it's time for you to stop doing life your way, to take and listen to the plea of Jesus Christ, to start doing it his way, and that you might find life abundantly. Today I want to offer to you that invitation, to the invitation to accept that gift of eternal salvation, to solidify your position with God, that you might know what happens to you in eternity. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. Today I want to give you that opportunity. Here's what I'm doing in just a moment. I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three, and I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I do that, I'm gonna ask you to do something real bold. I'm gonna ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're making a decision. You're saying, you know what? I want to follow God. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. So, oh man, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, the people I came with, they're going to see me. I feel like I'm going to be embarrassed. I don't know, I have the courage to do that. Listen, let me encourage you to shed that moment of embarrassment. I'm not going to embarrass you. But it's so much better, the decision that you're making. You have to make that decision. He says, if you confess me, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. It's your choice. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. You can do what you need to do, or you can sit there and do nothing. God's given you the free will choice like we talked about today. He's always there. He's given you the choice. Who should raise their hands? If you've never given him your heart, never given him your life, and that's you in just a moment, get ready. When I count to three, just pop your hand up. I'll see it. Who should raise your hands? Maybe you're not sure. Maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you prayed that prayer once long ago on TV, or you went to a Harvest Crusade, but you never really followed through with it. Listen, if that's you, don't walk out of this place today without making sure of your position with God. That's a gamble on your eternal life you just can't afford to make. Don't do it. Who should raise their hands today? If you've been living lukewarm, listen, if you've been running from God instead of to God, you've been tossed around doing life your way, trying to do life your way, or God's way, in between the middle, listen, stop living life like that. It's a terrible way to live. Get on God's side today. Let Jesus Christ give you that life that he so promised to you and I, that abundant life. It starts by making that decision to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You're making that decision. See, I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, I'll put it right back down, and together we'll follow through. But it starts by making that decision. You've had doctors and dentists and DMV appointments. Today it's a divine appointment. You're here at church tonight for a reason, to hear me talk, I don't know. Because God wants you to make that decision, and it starts today. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to the side, wherever you're at, even you guys in the family rooms, even if you're outside of the campus right now or outside of the auditorium, in the foyer or around here in the sound of my voice, or even at home, online, wherever you're at, today is the day of your salvation. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. When I count to three, if that's you, just get ready, pop your hand up. If you're watching online or at home, There's a little blue button. You can minimize your video and press the blue button. Somebody will pray with you online. Today is the day of your salvation. It starts by making that decision. I'm going to count to three. And when I do, be bold. Today, by giving your heart, born again, by giving Him all of your life, by giving Him all of your heart, starts by making that decision. We're going to do that together. Spirit of God speaking to you, if that's you in this place, get ready. When I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down. We'll go forward together from there. You ready? From the front to the back, side to side, wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time to give your heart, to give your life to Jesus Christ. Stop doing life your way. Start doing life God's way. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. You see your hands in this place today. You say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus today. One, two, three, four, five. Got you guys right over there. Cool. I got you right over there. Five people. Anybody else in this place say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on. Yes, you should. The goodness of God, the Bible says, draws men to repentance. If it's God speaking to your heart right now, say, man, come on. Jesus says, no one comes to the Father unless the Spirit draws him. Hey, don't spend the first few moments of your potential walk with God in rebellion by listening to the Word of God. Listen, I love you enough. I've been a little bit harsh. I know God wants to speak into your life and move in your life, and it starts by you accepting that gift. Four or five wise people in that area. How about you guys on this side? Come on. Say, man, I wonder if I should. Today, all right, ushers pointing over here. I see that. Five wise people. Six, I don't know how to count. I can't even count. Dad's really good at that. I'm not. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for five, six wise people. Praise God. Here's what we're going to do. All of you guys that raise your hand, if you didn't raise your hand, but maybe you should have, you say, man, I know I should have. The Spirit of God was speaking to me. I just had butterflies in my stomach, but I just didn't feel like I could. Listen, it's not too late. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You're making a decision. And you know, I know, every decision we make requires action. Otherwise, nothing happens. We're going to follow through together. We're going to act together. So if you raise your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, and you know that's you, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody or somebody brought you, hey, look to them and say, come on, I'll go with you. Or say, come with me. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me here at this altar. I want to change destinies with you together right here, right now. Let's all stand, please. Nobody leave. I know I kept you for a couple minutes, but if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, wherever you're at, come meet me up here today. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. That's your time. You come. That's you in this place. Come on, you can come. Yes. That's you in this place. You can come. Praise God. Hey, guys, listen. Great job. Somebody needs to tell you, good job, to encourage you. You're making the best decision you can possibly make. You know what that means? You're not going to a funeral. You can wipe that frown upside down, all right? Going to a birthday celebration. Today is the first day of the rest of your life, all right? You're going to get born again. Here's what I want to do. I want to just introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? You saw him in that video, real motivational. Music was playing, sun was shining behind him. His name is Pastor Joel, really cool guy. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, okay? He's going to do a couple things with you. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that very much anymore. The leader of your life. You're inviting Him into your life, okay? Second thing He's going to do, He's going to give you some free literature, some real easy reading. You're going to walk out of here and say, okay, what do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction. Real easy reading, 20 minutes. Take you to read through this little pamphlet just to get you on the right path. The last thing He's going to do is He's going to invite you to come back to church, to hang out with us. You heard the Word of God here. We want to get you connected with a friend. Connect you here with a friend to sit with you before church, teach you some things about the Word of God for just a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. Just meet with a friend. Somebody that will teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward and get strong in the ways that God has for you and everything that God has. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there, my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.